All right, joining us now on Hot Copy, we have Senator Francis Kiko Pangilinan, who we really invited on the program, setting the record straight, Senator, who agreed for the issue on rice and pork tariffs. Senator Kiko, good morning to you, sir.
Yes, good morning, Karen. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, but I can't see you.
There you are. You're back.
There.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, I need to get your reaction first because a lot of people were surprised by last night's the cabinet meeting, so to speak. It was the president's Monday night address. What do you make of former Senate President Enrile's advice that, number one, the president should ignore his critics when it comes to the West Philippine Sea dispute, and we should take a friendly stance towards China, and that the president is doing the right thing?
Well, of course, we disagree. Well, okay lang naman, tama naman. We should have a friendly, negotiated, diplomatic approach. And no one will dispute that. Pero iba naman yung usapan ng subservience at surrender. Mabuti pa nga ang Vietnam at Indonesia tumatayo at naninindigan kontra sa panghihimasok ng China. Hindi ba? Tayo, inuuna natin yung utang ng loob sa China, pero yung mga kapakanan ng ating mga mangingisda, hindi natin ipinagtatanggol. Hindi tama yun. There's one thing, it's one thing to be friendly and diplomatic. It's another thing to be subservient and tikumambibig o nananahimik o nagsusunod-sunuran. China is the aggressor here. Pero bakit ang binabatikos eh US? China is occupying key areas in our exclusive economic zone. We are talking of about 300,000 or 500,000 square kilometers that are now being threatened. Vietnam and Indonesia have shown the way na hindi naman kinakailangan girahin, pero pwedeng manindigan at tiyakin na ang sinasabi nila, ang atin ay atin at hindi natin ito isusuko kanino man. And yun ang dapat natin posisyon.
What do you make of... You have retired Senior Associate Justice Antonio Carpio, also a group of lawyers now, asking the president to retract his statements, saying the arbitral win was meaningless and China was in possession of the West Philippine Sea. Should the president retract his statement, Senator?
Well, that's up to the president. Whether he will, of course, is another question altogether. But we welcome these efforts to be able to clarify yung issue. No? So para nalalaman ng ating mga kababayan. So the position taken by retired Justice Carpio is a welcome opportunity, no, to further deepen yung ating awareness nitong issue laban sa China at sa pagprotekta ng ating soberenya at ang ating exclusive economic zone.
Mm-mm. Okay. Now, the issue, of course, is sovereignty and food security. At one point during the time of former President Aquino, you were former presidential advisor on food security. Before we move on to rice and pork, how will this affect food security if the West Philippine Sea issue is not handled correctly?
Well, right now, in our consultations with our fisher folk organizations, dati malaya silang nakakapag-pangisda dyan sa mga lugar na yan. At ang kita nila sa isang labas, 4,000 pesos. Mahina ang 4,000 pesos habang sila. Ngayon, tinataboy sila. So bagsak talaga ang kanilang kita dyan sa karagatan, sa lugar na in dispute. And ang record ay sinasabi about 170,000 metric tons of fish are being consumed or caught every day. Every day. That is food security. Ang pinakamurang source ng protina para sa ating mga kababayan ay isda. At napakahalaga ng protina para manatiling malusog ang ating mga kababayan. Tapos ang nangyayari, tinataboy ang mga mangingisda natin. Ngunit hindi natin ipinaglalaban at hindi ito tama. Kaya tama, matuto tayo sa Vietnam, matuto tayo sa Indonesia, naninindigan sila kontra sa panghihimasok ng China. At alam nyo ba, mas malaki pa ang investment ng China sa Vietnam In terms of direct investments ng Chinese money kumpara dito sa ating bansa. So hindi ibig sabihin kapag ikaw is nagsusunod-sunuran, iuunahin ka o bibigyan ka ng importansya. In fact, ang mga nagsusunod-sunuran, yun ang unang binabaliwala. Kaya dapat tayo naninindigan para maprotektahan natin ang ating mga ngisda, ang ating pagkain, at ang ating teritoryo at exclusive economic zone.
Okay, just quickly on this, Senator Kiko, should we already start drilling oil, or at the very least, I know that in the beginning, there was a, so to speak, it was halted in terms of finding out which areas of the West Philippine Sea we can source for power. But then President Duterte mentioned last night that Xi Jinping told him, if you do that, there will be trouble. I wanted you to react on that before we leave this subject.
Well, you know, Vietnam has taken a position on this issue with respect to their claims, Indonesia, and there has been no war.
Yeah.
And so that issue of trouble war, I doubt very much. No, war is parang tinatakot tayo para hindi tayo kumilos. Ba't tayo magpapatakot? Mm-mm. Tapos aangkinin nila yung 300,000 square kilometers. That's about the size of the entire land mass of the Philippines. 300,000 plus square kilometers. Mm-hmm. We will not speak up. We will keep quiet and we will say, paano tayo magkakaroon ng utang na loob sa China na inaagaw yung ating exclusive economic zone? Hindi tama.
Okay. All right. Now, from fish as food security in the West Philippine Sea, let's talk about rice and pork. Let's start first with rice. You said there will be a double whammy effect with the president's executive order lowering rice tariffs. Expound on this, Senator.
Well, actually, three issues. No. Number one, mukhang hindi na naman nakonsulta yung sektor ng industriya ng bigas. No. Ang Federation of Free Farmers, sinasabing walang konsultasyon. Number two, rice inflation is minus 0.3. Ibig sabihin,
hindi tumataas.
Yes. In fact, bumababa ang presyo ng bigas.
Mm-mm.
Which means, sufficient yung supply. Mm-mm. So bakit natin bibigyan ng prioridad yung mag-import? Mm-hmm. You import precisely because supply is short or kulang. Pero hindi naman kulang yung supply. Mm-mm. So bakit binaba from 50 to 35 and 40 to 35? Sino ang makikinabang dito? Ang mga importer. Pangatlo, mapabawasan yung korekta ng taripa. Ang taripa, pupunta dapat yan, yung excess ng 10 billion pupunta sa ating rice farmers at yung Rice Competitiveness Enhancement Fund. Di mababawasan yun. In fact, hindi double whammy. Hindi ba? Makikipagkompetensya na naman ang ating local rice farmers, imported na bigas, at the time when we don't have a shortage. In fact, there is minus 0.3% inflation. So what is this for?
Uh-oh. What do you think is the motive behind this or the intention, Senator Kiko, considering Malacanang defended the decision and said they just followed the recommendations of NEDA, and they said it's to make sure that there will be a diversified source of market.
Well,
in other words, yes, go ahead,
Yes. Yes, diversified because now imports from Pakistan, China, yung most favored nation kasi dalawa yan, no? Yung ASEAN, mas mababa yung tarifa kasi nga we are one community sa ASEAN, and then outside ASEAN mas mataas ang tarifa.
Mm-mm.
So ang ginawa nila, ginawa nilang mababa pareho, whether ASEAN or most favored nation. Ang kasama doon China, Pakistan at India.
Mm-mm.
So na right now pwede naman mag-import dito sa mga bansa na ito. Ang ginawa nila, ginawa na nilang mas mura yung bayad ng taripa. So importers at yung mga Chinese at Pakistani and Indian exporters, yan ang binibigyan ng pabor. Dito. Kaya hindi ko maintindihan. Importers na naman ang binigyan ng priority. Mabuti sana kung tumataas ang presyo ng bigas at kulang ang supply. Pati na rin ng Department of Agriculture, sinasabing hindi kulang ang supply. So ito'y hindi ko naintindihan saan nang gagaling itong pagbaba ng tarifa, pati sa bigas. Parang sinabay eh. Tapos wala pang consultation.
Okay.
Yun ang problema Binigla na naman ang industriya. Diyan magkakaroon ng dagdag na agam-agam sa nasabing sektor.
Now, can the president lower tariffs before Congress resumes?
Yes. And what we're preparing to do is file a joint resolution to withdraw that reduction of the tariff. Uh-oh. Whether we will get support or not is another question altogether. But that is also a power of Congress. Mm. Imposing taxes is really a power of the legislative branch. And in exceptions, given certain situations, the president is empowered. We delegate that power to the president, but only for a short period while we are not in recess, while we are not in session. And now that we're back in session, there's another question: was it published? If it was published, when will it take effect?
Yes.
And therefore, whether or not it is effective, of course, is something that we'd like to clarify.
And what about the timing of it? Because some have questioned the timing, that it was done precisely before Congress resumed.
Well, that was debated. That was discussed sa Senate, no? And in fact, yun na nga, pati yung support. No, the letter was forwarded to us the last day of our session.
Yes.
The law says that unless we act on it within 15 days from the time that we received the notice, then it becomes effective. Ang problema dito, and the law says if we do not act, it's not a question of whether we could act, whether we acted or not. It's a question of we could not act because we were on recess, and that is not the intention of the law. Mm-mm.
Senator Kiko, are you seeing possible interests in this particular decision? Clearly, you have importers that stand to benefit. Exporters from other countries that stand to benefit, but within the country,
I don't think this rice tarification, it's not as simple as that. But merong mga sumasakay, merong mga nakikinabang, merong mga naguudyok. Dahil we cannot take the rice tarification endorsement alone in isolation. Kasabayan ng pork. In fact, yung pork mas matindi dahil talagang kumbaga binukas na yung intention, malunod na tayo sa frozen pork. Which is precisely something that the Senate stood up against, and thankfully a compromise was met. From 404,000 metric tons naging 254,000 metric tons, and from a 5% and 10% tariff reduction, meaning reduction to 5% and 10%, naging 15% and 20%. So nagkaroon ng compromise, but precisely it was the vigilance of the Senate, the criticisms made by the Senate, and the concerns of the sector that made this possible.
Do you believe, Senator Kiko, that it may have the same effect again? Clearly, when the Senate made its sentiments known regarding the pork tarification and the MAV, the president adjusted his first decision. Do you believe it can happen again?
Well, we can only try. No, we will see. I haven't even a few kokonti lang na tumawag sa akin, dalawa pa lang ang tumatawag dahil hindi nabigla nga sila eh.
Okay.
So nice kong makausap din ang sektor ng the rice industry, no, the rice sector, the rice farmers. Mm-mm. And see anong pwede nating gawin dito sa pagbaba ng tarifa ng imported na bigas.
Okay. Very quickly, let's move on to pork. I spoke with Department of Agriculture Secretary William Dar, and the president's declaration of a state of calamity, he says, will make a difference in the support for the industry. What should be prioritized, Senator, quickly?
Tatlo. Yung indemnification sa mga magbababoy dahil close to 100 billion pesos worth of damages na ang naranasan ng hog industry. This will really affect our local hog industry and strategically yung ating source of pork, di ba? Pangalawa, so indemnification, bigyan sila ng suporta. Pangalawa, itong biosafety protocols.
Yes.
Kinakailangan i-fast track yung pagmamonitor ng labas-pasok ng frozen meat. This should be a priority because if we are not able to monitor the entry of the quality of meat from the imports, chances are makakalusot na naman itong African swine fever dahil kahit sa frozen pork, pwedeng na manatiling buhay itong swine fever. Pangatlo, itong cash for work para sa ating mga magbababoy at itong repopulation. Ibig sabihin, paramihin ulit dahil 3 million heads na ang pinapatay para hindi na kumalat itong swine fever. So all these three, nung wala pa yung state of calamity declaration, which we pushed since February, having been Food Security Secretary, we did that for a calamity, a pest management infestation sa Kokolisap, and we were able to address the problem in within 6 months. Nadagdagan ang pondo. With this state of calamity declaration, ngayon madadagdagan yung pondo ng DA. They can now source funds from the calamity fund of the national government. Without this executive order declaring state of calamity, kulang ng 6 billion yung 2021 African swine fever intervention ng DA. So they can now source more funds and focus on ensuring na ma-repopulate, diba? Magkaroon ng biosafety protocols and most importantly, yung suporta sa local hog industry, yung indemnification ng kanilang mga losses.
Oo. And I wanted to ask you clearly for the ASF to have gotten in the country, the Department of Agriculture admits that we need to improve border inspection. So apparently, parang mano-mano pa lang yung ating border inspection, Senator.
That is right. In fact, when I was Food Security Secretary, challenged na yan sa Bureau of Plant Industries. Because nung yung Kokolisap infestation, which destroyed over 2 million coconut trees in Calabar Zone, yung kanilang scientific assessment was that it came from imported plants.
Yes. So why can't we prioritize on this, Senator?
And this is part of the reason why we had the committee of on agriculture hearing and then the committee of the whole hearing, because may budget na for these biosafety protocols and border border controls, and they're now putting together precisely itong border control in infrastructure in place. Dapat sana mas maaga. Okay. But this should be the lesson learned. You know, billions have been lost precisely because of our porous borders. Mm-hmm. So if we are to spend 2-3 billion to ensure stronger border patrols, then we could have saved, and we will in the future save 100+ billion or more worth of damages precisely because we're able to protect our borders.
Okay, a few more issues. I hope you we get to this quickly. I know that the Senate will be adding more session days to approve priority measures. And what do you believe, what is your priority measure that you want to make sure is approved?
Well, Senator Ralph Recto has a Bayanihan 3 measure, and we would like to support that. How do we provide more stimulus for our economy? Sabi nga nila, if 2020 was bad for the economy, 2021 is worse. Because one, we have not effectively managed the spread of the disease. Two, there are new variants. Three, our vaccine rollout remains
slow,
spotty, and hopefully this will improve. But fourth, yung mga natabing savings ng ating mga kababayan noong 2020, ubus na. So gutom, mas matindi ang gutom ngayon. That's why the stimulus package, I think, should be followed through. Of course, there are other laws. Itong retail trade law, liberalization, kasama yan para pasiglahin ang ating ekonomiya given nga itong pagbagsak nito. And they're also working on the BARM postponement of the elections kasi dapat 2022 magkaroon na ng BARM elections after yung interim set of officials. Pero dahil sa COVID, hindi na saayos yung ilang pinakailangan ponduhan. Mm-mm. So they're saying we need to postpone the BARM elections. We support that too. And so Bayanihan 3 for me is the priority.
Yes.
Although unfortunately, mukhang iba-iba ang sinasabi ng executive department. The Department of Trade wants additional funding. But it seems the body language is, where do we get the funds?
Yes.
And that's the challenge.
Okay. And just very quickly, are you also running the Senate version of Senator Recto is also at 405 billion? Is it the same, roughly?
Yes. But I think sa House, it's 485 billion. So we will have to figure out. But the important thing is we have to put money in the pockets of our people.
Okay.
So that they can spend and so that they can eat. And address these challenges of hunger. It's real, especially in urban centers like Metro Manila.
Okay. Senator, just two more questions very quickly. Vaccination, you have your colleagues already calling for the government to bump up the A4 already right now, because right now we're vaccinating A1 to A3 and it's been slow. You have elderlies that are hesitant, some that don't want to get vaccinated, but you have a lot of the economic frontliners that are frankly, you know, raring to get vaccinated so they can go back to work, but then they're not yet in the A4. So what is your stand on this?
We have had more lessons learned, no? And more data coming in na yung mga nagtatrabaho, sila rin ang nag-spread kasi sila lumalabas . At sila rin ang so kinakailangan talagang i-review itong patakaran tungkol doon sa mga...
Should we re-strategize? Kasi may nagsasabing iba, kung sino na gusto magpabakuna, pabakunahan nyo na at the end of the day. To achieve herd immunity is you need to get people vaccinated.
Yes. In fact, the data, for example, sa Italy, 13.7 million have been vaccinated. But this is Pfizer, AstraZeneca, and Moderna. And 80% ang reduction ng infections.
Uh-oh.
90% ang reduction ng hospitalizations. Mm-hmm. And 95% ang reduction ng deaths.
Uh-oh. So should we bump up A4 already, Senator?
I think so. But at the same time, we have to make sure na mabilis yung rollout. Mm-hmm. Kasi isang linggo, 30,000 eh. Dapat yan, 500,000 a day.
Yes.
And that's why I will go back to the issue of we need to get local governments mobilized and the private sector mobilized. Okay. Kung ang DOH lang ang nakamobilize dito, eh hindi uubra. We really need the army on the ground, the infantry on the ground, and that will be provided for by the private sector together with the LGUs.
Okay. All right. My last question is about the 2022 elections. I know that the Liberal Party is eyeing to recruit 75,000 new members and volunteers, but more than that is, did you know that Senator Antonio Trillanes, Senator Antonio Trillanes wanted to run for president? That particular announcement that Vice President Lenny Robredo was eyeing for a local post.
Well, that has since been clarified.
No? Yes, she clarified it.
Not made a decision. Yes. And therefore, eyeing that gubernatorial or local post is inaccurate. And number two, Senator Sani has said that if VP Lenny decides, then he will step aside. So I think marami pang mangyayari, kaya pwede natin abangan. Pero I think ang dapat mangyari ngayon sa halip na pag-usapan sino bang mga kandidato, we can do that maybe 2-3 months from now. Pag-usapan natin paano magparehistro pa ng mas marami.
It's very true.
Because 73 million ang sinabi ng PSA at COMELEC na eligible voters for 2022.
Yeah.
But only 58 million are registered. So that's about a whopping 15 million citizens who are not registered. Yeah. Almost 16 million, in fact. And we know 16 million is a magic number. Mm-hmm. And that's why before, Puga, wag nating, let's not put the cart before the horse.
Yeah.
Let's get the voters registered. Itong lalo na yung mga kabataan, maraming hindi rehistrado.
Okay.
Hopefully, with the support of the COMELEC, mas marami tayong mapaparehistro dun sa 16 million na hindi rehistrado. Sabi nila, eh, anong gagawin ko?
Okay.
Isang utulong ako. Eh, yung problema nun, ang dami nang sabi ng ganun, kaya 16 million na.
All right.
Rehistrado. So, okay. Pagbaguhin natin yan.
On that note, Senator Francis Kiko Pangilinan, what a pleasure it is to speak with you this morning. Thank you very much.
Ano ang sinasabi ng mga baboy ngayon? Anong nararamdaman nila?
Is this a joke?
Yes.
But go ahead, sir. Ano?
Nararamdaman nila pig hati.
On that note, we're going to go on a quick break. Thank you so much
for
your time this morning.
Good morning.
Stay strong.
Good morning.
Stay well, Senator Kiko Pangilinan. Thank you.